Tuesday night podcast.
The Beat Radio Bali.
And we'd like to welcome you to the show.
Welcome to the show.
Welcome.
Welcome to the show. It's Tuesday night live in Pochanggu. Maybe better Brower.
I'm going to go with Brower there, Stu.
I think we've got to go with Brower since we are in Brower. I'm talking to Brett Allen from Rave Radio. You might have heard of Rave Radio. Not to be mistaken for rave parties.
We were huge before COVID, you know.
Absolutely. We were all huge before COVID. Anyway, we start the show with three very simple questions.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do you got for me?
Yeah. Let's think what they are. Where are you from? How old are you? How did you get involved in DJing?
I'm from the Gold Coast in Australia. If anyone doesn't know where that is, which they should, it's below Brisbane by about 45 minutes. I am just turned 32 years old, so I'm 32 years old just recently. I believe you were at my party last week, Stu.
It was a good party, indeed. You weren't at mine, but okay. Mine was bigger for many reasons, but...
Didn't get an invite to yours, mate. I invited you two times to mine.
Didn't I invite you?
No.
I'm sure I did.
Nah, definitely didn't get one.
Oh. It was COVID, you know.
It was social distance. We have a cap on the numbers.
Anyway, so tell us about how you got involved in... wait a minute. Where are you from?
The Gold Coast.
Gold Coast. Amazing place.
It's a paradise. It's a very good place.
Really?
Great place to grow up.
Which part of Gold Coast?
Surface paradise. Right in the middle.
But that's where it's all kind of...
Yeah, like just...
Cool,
just,
you know, money... Yachts, big fancy buildings.
Yeah, lots of empty holiday rental buildings.
Nowadays.
Yeah. No, it's a great place to grow up, and the beaches there are just amazing. Anyone that's been will agree.
White sand. Lots of beautiful women.
Lots of tan men.
Wow. Whatever you're into. It's okay. We go both ways on Tuesday night.
It's the Beat Radio, and anything goes.
So what effect did that have on you? Well,
how I got into the DJ business is my family used to own a nightclub there. Mm. So for about 27 years.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Too close? Okay.
All right. Boom.
And then I just naturally, about 13, got into it. I was just like, Dad had all the vinyl decks at home. And,
all right.
And then I was just
was
like,
he a DJ?
No, he was the boss, but he like used to have all the DJs set up at home so the DJs could practice
right
before they play there.
Okay. So what was the club?
Melba's. Yeah.
Famous.
27 years he had it. So a long time.
And so you were basically brought up in the game.
Yeah. That probably explains a lot of why I'm so strange now.
Well, it probably explains why you're here now.
Yeah. So, obviously, then when I started DJing, I didn't think I'd actually end up touring all over the world doing it. I just wanted to play in Brisbane was my dream, to play in Brisbane and Sydney.
So, when did you actually play live the first time?
When I was 13.
So,
I remember
was that?
The song was Tom Novi, Your Body, and then I still didn't really know how to mix properly, and the DJ just passed me the headphones on a Saturday night and was just like, there you go. I'm like, shaking.
What time?
1 a.m.
Right, peak hour.
Peak hour, underage, you know.
Under the table, I don't know, maybe you're a
tall remember
kid.
Back then, I was just, my dad said, just wear a long Hugo Boss shirt and don't leave the DJ box and you should be fine.
Well, obviously your dad's a good fella.
That was before the too many rules came into Australia.
Mm.
It used to be a lot looser back then.
Right. So what's happened now? No children allowed, no...
Since then, you know, you have to be 18 plus and show your ID, you know. Before, you could just look old and walk into somewhere, right? And you just run the gauntlet, whether
I'm
you
trying
get
to think
asked.
Of how long ago that was, 20 years ago, right?
Yeah, 10.
All right, so, wait a minute. Yeah, you're 32, so, yeah. Anyway.
Getting on.
Yeah, so, you became like a world touring DJ. Now, tell us about that. Wait a minute. Tell me about EDM. How did you get involved in EDM?
Well, I didn't even know. Yeah, it's strange, that one, because I didn't really know what it was going to be when we started. We just started playing club music, and that just evolved into a culture. Like, it's kind of when Hardwell became big, but we were already playing, like, whatever the big tracks were on Beatport at the time. Mm. And for, like, 10 years, it was always that type of music. And then I think it was when we grew in Asia is when we got... put in the EDM category.
Yeah. But there was a point in like 2013 probably where
it
all kind of changed.
Like many, but Sky Garden was my very first Asian gig. I remember the first time I did Sky Garden, and then Taiwan in the same weekend.
Well, you're not the first one to say that.
Yeah, no, everyone's
sure.
I'm pretty sure every DJ on the planet's played at Sky Garden, you know.
Pretty much. Except for every EDM.
Except for Johnny.
Yes.
Johnny boy.
He didn't get a chance, did he?
His time was too soon.
He's
too good looking for that place.
Into his techno.
Yeah. Johnny is the king of techno, Bali. The king.
Anyway, it's not about Johnny. Okay, it's about you.
Okay.
Talk about Johnny later.
Yeah,
so it's kind of an interesting world, suddenly get involved in all this touring and stuff.
I think too, another thing is it's just a bit of luck too. We got in at the right time, especially in Asia. Like, we're in China before EDM took off, into these markets, and then as it took off, we went up with it.
So what was happening before EDM took off?
Oh mate, China was crazy. Like, each city I'd go to, you'd think you figured out what they like, and they had no idea.
Right.
Like, I'd like go to one place where I'd play psytrance, then the next night play R&B, and then sometimes psytrance into R&B because they just didn't know what the hell they were into.
Right.
Now, since they got onto like the Tomorrowlands and the YouTubes and that, they just want flat out hard music from start to finish. You don't even have to do warm up. You just go full throttle from the second you start.
And that was Rave Radio, basically.
Just energy, energy.
You know, is it still the same now, Rave Radio?
Yeah, of course. Right. It's just my partner's in Australia and I'm in Bali, so it makes it hard to tour.
And how long have you been producing?
I'd say 10 years. Yeah, right. 2009 we started Rave Radio, so 10 years.
And it started off, what style of music?
Just writing like house, like always with vocals. But for the first like 4 years, we were just like messing around with it. We didn't really know what we were doing. We just kind of, we were like one of those artists that made every mistake possible when we started.
Mm.
Bad photos, bad branding, bad music.
Sometimes it works.
Still bad music. No.
I'm sure people love it. And, you know, EDM, okay, I like to ball it out.
Oh.
I like to give it a hard time.
Stu, you are a baller, mate.
I like to give everything a good time. You know, when you listen to it, I get it. You know, it's like...
EDM became so... It wasn't about, like... It's just about the experience and the visual sensation and the energy.
The whole
and it's just like...
uplifting thing. Yeah.
You know, like... Whereas I personally like house and techno. But, like, unless you really like that style... Whereas EDM's kind of just for everyone. People that don't even know anything about music, they just get around the vibe and get into it like that.
Yeah, but you can also get into the vibe when it's, you know, Carl Cox or someone.
But the difference is with EDM, like when you do performance, EDM's about keeping everyone's focus at that point and not dropping it, whereas techno's like, you know, journey, and you just like,
you know. But it's all about the drop. Right?
The drop, and then you wait for that build, when's it going to drop? Yeah. No one knows.
And the drop before you get into the club. Yeah. Anyway.
And okay.
Well, we don't go there. And whereas the EDM is more about the drop, as in guzzling.
Everything's synchronized too. It's like, here it comes. One, two, three, let's go.
Oh, yeah, it's crazy.
And then you know something crazy is going to happen when it hits. Fireworks go off or confetti.
Yeah.
Remember the confetti cannon at Shishi? Oh, sorry, not Shishi.
Sky Gun. Yeah.
The CO2.
and the dancers. You know, the dancers in between them. You know, the warm-up set.
I remember talking to the AV staff there, and with the confetti, they used to manually hold it and just spray it over the crowd. And they even put CO2 into the confetti so it shot out more.
And then later gather it up and put it in the
mop
gun
it back out. Reload, mate. You know, running a business, not a...
not heaven.
I swear there was some, you know, when people get wet tissue paper on their head, they're like, what is that? Anyway, this is going way off topic.
Absolutely. No, well, it's all about the music, you could say. Actually, it's all about the entertainment, really.
That's what really EDM is entertaining. And the Asian...
And for the masses, right?
For the masses. Mm. And it's like crowd control and just... That's what... And in Asia, I guess that's why we did so well in Asia, is people want entertainment. You know, they want to be... Like, they just want entertainment when they party. When you go to like a techno thing, people are normally there because they know the DJ, and they just like, they won't know their songs, they just know the DJ, you know.
Yeah, that's what it's all about. That's what it's about here with the radio as well.
Yeah,
because all these sets that we play are people basically that you trust, yeah, are going to play a certain style of music, and that's what.
Why did you delete about. Johnny's set before off the? Was it clogging up the hard drive?
Yeah, well, you know, as I said, it's not about Johnny. It's about Brett Allen, all the way from Queensland,
Gold Coast,
Australia, and
Queensland
Rave Radio, not to be mistaken for a good rave party.
Yeah. Anyway, back to it.
All right, so you're touring the world, you know, that's pretty exciting.
I've definitely been I've been very fortunate with it. When I started, I didn't think I'd see parts of the world I've been to, and I feel very humbled and grateful to be able to have done it. Even just, I would never have thought of some of the parts of like Brazil I've been to and Europe.
Where have you been?
I've been to every continent except for Africa. I haven't done Africa, but I've done.
I guess there's only South Africa. I'm not sure what's going on down there.
I'd be down for a festival in Congo if anyone's throwing one.
Jesus, yeah. I saw a documentary, Day Way documentary on YouTube about Congo.
I saw the movie Congo the other night, the one with the gorilla.
All right, it's probably different.
Okay. Okay.
Was that with King Kong?
No. It's called Congo. It's in the... Right. Yeah, anyway, we're going off topic here.
Anyway, this was all about Congo, and I tell you what, you wouldn't want to go there. Unless you want trouble. But it's a bit like going down to Sky Garden. And we're already talking about it. I was going to say Shishi, but better not to talk about Shishi.
No.
When we're talking about trouble. Anyway.
Bad nights, bad memories.
That was a great night I had down there last Saturday, actually, until I had to pull out.
We're still cleaning up the dance floor. You shredded it.
I like to bring, you know, the attention my way.
When the finger pointers are up, it's game on, you know.
So anyway, being a young guy, I guess you were, you know, 20s, right?
I was 26 when I started traveling around. I think I didn't actually play there, but still the coolest place I've been to is New York City. I spent about 10 days there in between shows. Amazing place.
But you're in the US playing?
So the funny story is when we were like expanding, I was like, we have to go to America. We have to go. This is like when I go back to when I was saying we made many mistakes. We just thought we had... So I managed to find an agent, the tourist there, and I managed to get a bunch of shows there, like when we were real young in our career. And then, so we went there and we were like, touring America, but the shows were terrible.
I remember... Wait, how?
I played in Connecticut at some casino.
So they're not like festival
shows? No. I played in like bars and then we'd still do our set in like a bar and everyone's like, can you turn it down?
Can you play a real song?
Where are you folks from? You know, like...
I can imagine...
I actually did one rave in a place called Beaver, and it's outside Beaver. It was outside Pittsburgh, and I had to literally drive from New York there in a rental car. It was pretty insane. It was like 7-hour drive from New York City out to this place called Beaver, and it was the strangest festival I've been to. Like, I was like, what am I doing here?
How does that come about?
The funniest thing is when I started, because of the time difference, when we did that our gig at Connecticut, I played Friday night in Broad Beach on the Gold Coast, and because of the time difference, the next night flew to New York and played Saturday night in Connecticut because it went back. So I remember landing in New York. I had barely slept, and I had to drive 2 hours to Connecticut. Never driven on the other side of the road. I've come out of the airport. This is at JFK, New York. Wrong side. I've gone up the opposite side ramp, and cars come like, oh, shit. And I remember I thought it'd be like Australia where there's service stations everywhere. And I was like, I need Red Bull. Where's the servo? No servos. Fuck. Red Bull. And then the whole way there, I was like, could barely drive and then had to play as soon as I got there. Like,
but how do you get a gig like that? That's the first time you're in the States.
Yeah.
In this
we just
Beaver like, place.
I don't know how I did it. I just hustled it and just managed to make it work.
Is it through agents?
Yeah, I had an agent. You actually, by law, need an agent in America. You can't just do it yourself.
A US agent.
Yeah. And I paid like $6,000 for our visas. It was a disaster. Like, we lost so much money on this tour. And then we were there for like a month because we thought we would have like gigs fall through, one come in, and like all happening like last minute. And then went to Brazil. We had a festival in Brazil as well, so I thought I was touring the world, but I was just like on a giant holiday. And then I'd come home to Australia. How was the tour? I'm like, it was pretty hectic. You know, I did like 5 gigs in a month. So what'd you do in between? Oh, you know, sightseeing and photos and walks on the park.
Didn't sort of hang out in clubs and all that stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It was good. It was, so I've been fortunate to see a lot of cultures. Where I started really enjoying the world was in Asia. That's why I really liked Asia.
And a lot of time in China.
China's cool. I like China. Sounds of it. Yeah, China is probably our strongest market. Mm. I've done probably 25 cities in China now. So a lot of cities there. And each club there is crazy, man. They're like all bigger than Las Vegas clubs, every city. They just latched onto it and just built, because they have the money, they just build these massive super clubs.
And how are the people inside?
Yeah, they're all right.
Interesting bunch.
Yeah, like China's all about tables. Yeah. So many clubs, it's only in the recent years that have full fake dance floors. So you could just play no music and everyone, that's like they're synchronized to dance. And they do this, everyone buys tables, so it's a real strange place. But you also have a lot of fun DJing.
But there must be some decent clubs there too, right?
The best clubs I've ever played are in Shanghai. Yeah. I still think one of my favorites in Asia is Illusion in Phuket. That place is crazy.
Oh, that's down on Bangla Road?
Have you been?
I have.
Yeah, it's a crazy place. It was actually where one of our big viral videos happened for Linkin Park. We had like 18 million views on this video on Facebook.
What was that video?
Funny story. It was us playing Numb live on the drum pad, and we published it, and then the next day the guy died by coincidence, and then it just kind of picked up viral because he died. Oh, and then it looked like,
sorry.
Yeah, yeah. Rest in peace, Chester. And it went mega, mega viral because the timing was just weird like that. Just got lucky.
But it's a good name, right? Rave Radio.
Thank you.
It's kind of like
The Beat Radio.
Yeah,
just similar. Same.
I hope you have as much success.
I really do miss the good old days at Sky Garden. We used to play like once or twice a year, and they were always the best gigs. Because it used to, you know, Kuta used to have that crazy...
Oh, yeah.
Like, it was like a festival every night.
When did you first play there?
My first gig in Bali was at a bar called Icon, actually.
Okay, up the road.
Up the road. Mm. And then I played Sky Garden. Jeez. I was trying to think, hey, maybe 2015 or 16.
Oh, so it's kind of recent.
Oh, no, history. But like I think I had 4 years of doing gigs there maybe.
Oh, right.
But I did my two gigs there before they had all the LED screen in there, so it was really odd. When they put all the LED in, it just changed the whole place?
Yeah, around the edges.
But like it totally made going it. Going everywhere. That's when Sky Garden went crazy busy, when that LED stuff went in.
That was a lot of LED going on. I remember having a beat party there, and I think it was in 2012, 13. I'm not sure. Anyway, they hadn't finished the place yet. In typical Sean style, you know, hey, it's okay, we'll go ahead.
Yeah.
I mean, right there, it's like 100 people up in the roofs and welders and finishing to build the place.
That's Bali style, isn't it? We're opening no matter what.
Yeah. And we got away with it somehow. Somebody ended up in hospital. Edward. Sorry, mate.
Not mentioning names.
But, it was a crazy night, and Sky Garden was a crazy place. But, Sky Garden never sort of made it with the Seminyak kind of underground crowd.
It's crazy that too, isn't it? Like it feels now that Seminyak is the cheesy crowd, doesn't it? But then also Canggu also feels like... Like, if you drive around the streets of Canggu during the day, it's like Kuta, right?
Well, the whole thing's very Kuta-ish. Yeah. And we've lost that upper end, underground.
We've lost a lot of people. We've lost a lot of people in the pandemic.
But I do remember, a gig I went there, it was Paul Van Dyke, right?
It was
on a Sunday night or something. Went down there with some friends. And I thought, wow, man, you can get away with this. Because it attracted that whole... kind of people that are interested in trance.
But you know what it was like towards the end? Like, it was in, like, the traffic to get there in a car is ridiculous. Terrible. I remember I was staying in Legian once, and Sean was like, you got to stay near the club. And I was like, no, I'll stay. And I left 2 hours before I was meant to be there, and then I ended up having to get out of the car and run down Legian to make my set time. Because it was like 2 hours from Legian to Sky Garden.
It was impossible to get there.
Yeah.
Because the taxi drivers would just fall asleep in the car.
Yeah, yeah.
And no one could get through,
And it became such a mission that people in Canggu would never go there.
It all changed. It all changed about
people don't even come up to Seminyak now from Canggu.
Oh, they're completely different places, aren't they?
They're like, all of Bali's completely separated now. Everyone has their own areas, and then they stay in their areas, don't they?
And now, like with the COVID, the Brower, particularly Brower, lesser extent, Batabulong, is busier than any place in town.
For sure, yeah. It's like where everyone lives, right? Brower and Canggu.
Whereas
like,
Seminyak, Kuta.
Yeah, like once you like Umalas people, and then like once you get to that Petty Tangut thing, it's like no one lives there.
No, man. But then there's also, you know, you go...
I think the people up...
5 minutes that way, and it's, like, normal.
I reckon all the people up in the tourist areas in villas are living the dream. It's nice and quiet, you know.
If you're not depending on tourists for your money, and there is a lot of people in town that don't...
you'd be loving
it. Manufacturing or whatever they're doing, exporting, they love it, yeah.
Yeah, that's sometimes...
They don't want it. They don't want the tourists to come back.
I feel in Bali at the moment, it's like... You got to really enjoy this time we have right now because it's not good. Once it's over, it's going to be so uncomfortable again here.
Wow, uncomfortable. I've lived here for, you know, 37 years.
Sorry.
No, the first time I was here was 41 years ago.
Yep,
you've been following the show. You've got to follow the show every week. Anyway, I've seen it change from back when it was one road down to the beach, and that was it.
Okay.
It was one road down from Denbasar. That was the...
And it was just chaos, was it?
No, it was okay. But it is always like a cosmopolitan international feel.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there's people from all over the world. You know, back then it was probably like backpackers and stuff.
And Aussies.
Yeah, just a mix. And it's still a mix now.
Have you seen that... what's that old skits song they do? Is it... We go to Kuta.
Yeah, we go. Have you been to Bali or something?
Hey, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I got a guitar.
Yeah. Let's go to Kuta.
But, okay.
Yeah, so I think...
Before Sky Garden died, you know, was put to rest.
I think it was, yeah.
It had already changed
that the market. That was the last legs of Kuta, wasn't it? Once Sky Garden closed, that was it.
The market then was like Middle Eastern, Indian, and Chinese, sort of.
Fantastic.
And all the Australians are already gone.
Yeah, yeah. They all go to the goo man.
That's what gets me when you see all these videos that they're on, you know, the tourist, wait a minute, the news stories about how terrible Bali is, and they show Kuta. Oh, Kuta's so empty. But, man, it was already a year before COVID, it was already dead.
Do you remember that show they did in Australia, What Happens in Bali? Did you hear about that?
Which one?
There was a Channel 7, it was a Channel 7 show, and it was like, What Really Happens in Bali?
Oh, they come in here, and then like a series.
Yeah, and they'd be like, this is Jan. Jan buys vegetables for the locals, and then they get a scene of it. All right, go off and run it and get hit by a scooter. Oh no, people get.
Oh my god, everyone's dying.
Think twice about your kids going to Bali.
And that's why they love it.
Yeah,
because there's no rules, and everyone in Australia is just so to the eyeballs with rules.
Yeah, and that's why when they come back over after COVID, they're gonna go crazy, mate. I don't see it any other way. And every other country will staggeredly come back here, but there will be a day when Australia goes, that's the day they're landing. And
God.
Yeah, it's going to be crazy.
So what are we going to do to prepare for that?
Well, I told the guys at Finns, I'm like, you better get like four times the amount of security guards. Yeah, I said, there's going to be fights left, right and centre.
All that pent up energy.
Yeah, especially 2 years of suppression in Australia. Like, people will lose their mind. Too much rules.
They're saying that about the Gold Coast, actually, now. I read an article the other day.
Property market's booming there at the moment.
No, but all these kids, everyone's going on holiday up there, and they reckon it's the new Bali, where everyone's just going crazy.
Oh, really? So, that's what it used to be like. When we had our club, it was up until 2007. From the Olympics up till then, was crazy.
Yeah.
Pumping. Like, the Gold Coast was out of control, busy.
And then?
Then the GFC hit and just reset everything a bit. Okay. And that was when everyone went to surface, kind of like what everyone used to go to Kuta. And then it started branching out. People went to Broad Beach and then this. And now it's kind of like the same as Bali, Gold Coast. It's like surface is Kuta, Broad Beach is Seminyak, and then Burley is Canggu, and then so forth and so forth. And then
but surface paradise has always been the upper end.
No, Broad Beach is the more upper end now. But now it's moving south towards the border. So Burley Heads is like the cool spot now.
Oh, really?
Do you know these areas I'm talking about?
I just lived down that way 20 years ago.
Yeah, you lived in the Goldie.
Yeah.
Nice, mate. Do you wear DTs on the beach?
Most I'm likely. Not sure what DTs are, but...
Dick togs.
Dick togs.
Dick togs.
Are they like what I call speedos?
For speedos, yeah. DTs, mate.
I was wearing boardies, mate. I was surfing.
I'm a bodyboarder.
We'll let you off.
Yeah.
That. Anyway, I'm not sure what's happening there on the Twitch, but we are going live on Twitch.
We're doing this no matter what.
We're over here. We're over there. Hope you're enjoying the show. We're talking to Brett Allen. He's from Rave Radio. Not to be mistaken for a good rave party. And we love a good rave party.
Who doesn't? Seriously.
When did you first get into electronic music and why? What was it that attracted you? Let me add to this. Aussie kids are basically into live music, right?
Yeah, like more so now they are. Like, I don't know. I guess having being exposed to the nightclub music at such a young age made me. And then I used to hear like DJ Sash, like Ecuador, and that shit. I was like,
oh, you'd have international DJs coming by?
No, we were like a top 40 venue, but I had to learn all the music, and then I just was like listening to music all the time.
Hmm.
And then I don't know, like I like all music, but I just don't like rap music. Like it's just not my thing. Like I like Biggie, Tupac, sure, but like all this new stuff, it's not for me.
Not even sure what that is. But anyway,
no
mumble rap.
I don't know. I just got into it at a young age and just loved it. I love most of the music I love is not stuff I play. By the way, I love techno, like melodic stuff.
How about production or musical instruments? Did you learn music?
Yeah, I used to play. I was in the Gold Coast Orchestra for viola. It's nice. You know what viola is?
Similar to a violin.
Yeah, it's just a
bigger.
Bigger.
Mm.
And it's a. I was smarter. I knew all the Asian kids played violin and none of them played viola. So I was like, if I want to make the band, I've got to do the thing no one's doing.
One step ahead.
And it was only me and another guy on the Gold Coast that did viola. So
how far did you go with viola?
Once I made it up until grade 11, and even all my mates were paying me out for it. Like I'd done some gigs, mate. I did one with the Sydney Youth Orchestra at our school, and I used to get those ones, the vibrato.
All right.
And then everyone used to
pull your chicks or doing the vibrato.
No, I went to an all boys school, so I don't know. Maybe a few few fellas.
Well. Yeah. Watch out for them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Don't drop the soap.
Yeah, but there was always a girl's school nearby, I guess, and you'd have these socials.
Yeah, I went to a boys' school
too. But, yeah,
I was a bit of a much bigger man than I was now when I was a kid. I was quite heavy. Yeah,
a bit of a Sean style.
Slimming.
Hi, Sean.
How are you, mate? Yeah. Proudly sponsored by The Forge this year.
Everything well.
We're doing 1K wings for all day long.
Yeah, don't eat too many of them. What was I going to say?
Into it at a young age. I started learning guitar as well.
And did that help you with because you're involved in production?
Yeah. I think for electronic music, which I didn't learn, which I regret now, is piano. I think with electronic music, it's all chord based. So like if you know your chord progressions, you can make anything with electronic music because you're just programming chords.
Well, you have chords, guitar, right?
Yeah, but it's key chords, and when you do it on the sequences and stuff,
keyboards. Isn't it?
It's all keyboard, MIDI controllers, and essentially piano based. So, if you can do piano, then it's a huge win. So do piano.
So what's the biggest hit you had as Rave Radio? Was there a big one?
Yeah, we had some popular songs, but nothing that went like mega. Like we've had some songs on Channel V top charts in Australia.
Mm.
Had a couple of Beatport top tens. Where Rave Radio really took off was our viral drum pad videos. So we got quite popular from getting viral online, especially on Facebook.
What is that about?
Well, is when we used to do like these live videos and they'd just go viral and everyone would share them. Like
live videos.
You'd do like we used to do these little short
viola.
Yeah, no, because in our live shows we had the drum pad, so we used to do like
live
right mashups, and people used to love it.
Mm.
Are you looking me up, eh?
I'm gonna play a track.
Go on Spotify.
I don't like Spotify.
Oh. But our new ones are on Spotify.
I might get ads because I don't do it.
Just look it up on there and see what you can come up with.
All right. What are we doing?
Rave Radio.
But as soon as I do this, the powers that be at Social Media World ban you, everything. Ban everything because you played someone's song.
Even Gojek?
Gojek, let's not talk about Gojek.
Yeah, let's save that for another episode.
They're my favourite whinge, actually. I hate them.
Oh, yes. They're not so...
I call them the Green Army. And they're the ones that are always in your way when you're driving. You notice that?
They are. And they drive so slow and clog up the road.
Yeah, they're sitting on their phone in front
of
you.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. Anyway, Trouble.
That's one of our newer ones.
All right. That's a month ago.
Yeah, it's performing... most of our streams come through Spotify now, not here.
And... I don't know if it's going to work or anything happens.
It's playing, but you know.
Nothing's happening. Thank you very much. We've got to put this up. Oh, I've got to put this down. Let's do that again. Trouble. Tell me a bit about Trouble.
James wrote this one. I was actually in Bali when he wrote this. He wrote it in Sydney with some singer.
It's a big hit. Yeah. she was amazing.
Yeah, no, and he shot the music video on the Gold Coast.
Well, is this a typical Rave Radio track?
We've been making a lot of different songs, but this is like one of our newer ones.
It's a bit balladish, right? Huh?
Wait for the drop.
Yeah, we'll just wait a minute. No, we talked through our way through it.
Yeah, well, during COVID, obviously, like when it all started, it kind of really shook up the electronic world with, like. Why, like before you used to release these tracks because you're playing at shows, festivals, clubs, and it kind of just, you got a bit confused. Oh, there you go.
You know, it's like the hard on moment, right?
Yeah, but many electronic, especially EDM guys, have all fallen in the same boat. Like releasing music now when all the clubs are closed and no parties in the world, it's like, it's almost pointless. Like you put them out and then they don't do anything because no one's doing anything.
It's so a funny time, isn't it?
It's a strange time. Like if you listen to this other song, Space Jam, it's like a complete pop song from us that we'd never play in a set because it's too slow.
Well, let's play that then.
Yeah, give it a little press.
Space Jam. And does this get your radio play or...
This one went okay, but when you do the radio stuff, you're competing against Bruno Mars and stuff. It's tough. We've had some tracks come very close to cracking radio, but then they get to the stage where they're like Calvin Harris or Rave Radio, and then of course go with Calvin Harris, you know, on a song because he's got the name.
Is that on Australia-wide radio?
Yeah, Australia, we've had a lot of good success in Australian radio. With our club music, it's more on Beatport. The club music doesn't get the streams on Spotify. So that we do more, since the COVID, we've been doing more songs you can like listen to, not so much club music, which is kind of, and then we're holding on to the club records until COVID ends. Which,
well, apparently it's happening soon, right?
Yeah, July, Bali said.
Well, yeah, and also in the UK, I was talking to a friend yesterday over there. And
funny you say that about the UK. I was looking at heaps of stuff today, and they're really pushing for, like, they're back on.
Well, they've got a lot of shows organised, June, July, I'm not sure.
Yep.
Or even May, I think, where they're doing all this testing before you go in.
They've released all the lineups, all the festivals, like they're 100% happening, haven't they? Like I see artists releasing their schedules. Creamfields is happening.
Well, they've got all their vaccines, haven't they?
Yeah.
There's like half of the population.
Whoever thought the Pommies would be the first to win?
It's funny, isn't it?
They had the first to roll it out.
It's coming, and they've poisoned everyone else apparently with
God Save the Queen.
AZ one.
Oh yeah, we can get that one in Bali, can't we? The AstraZeneca.
Well, there was a top politician that died last weekend. He had it.
Soft.
He had the
Chinese one or the Astra?
Astra.
And he killed him.
The vaccine, and then 2 weeks later he dies, and they're going, yeah, okay. That's a good idea, getting the vaccine.
Yeah.
He might have got it somewhere. I don't know.
I might just buy my vaccine certificate off Katuk.
Katuk is always a handy guy to have.
Yeah, at Minimart.
Yeah, that's what people are saying now, aren't they? But
they're funny, aren't they? I was having a coffee at Watercress the other day. This guy just pulls up on his bike, looks at me. Would you like some weed? And I'm like, no, I'm good, thank you. No, I don't want to die. they're funny, aren't they?
Well, you know, there's never any harm in smoking a bit of weed. Anyway,
coming to you live from Bra.
Yeah.
You know, deep. in the middle of it.
Yes, mate. This is where it all happens.
We're just so close to the Shady Pig.
I'm going to mention that. We are so close to Shady Pig. Is anyone of you in Shady Pig? Just tell us about it on...
Now. Could go somewhere on Moscow Mule right about now.
Anyway, I've been drinking our wine as well.
Yeah.
The Classico.
I like it. Very nice drop.
Okay, so...
So,
there you are.
DJing.
This young, you know, world...
Hunky.
Challenging, fucking touring producer DJ.
EDM powerhouse.
Because it's handy having been a producer, right?
Cause yeah, yeah.
Then people ask, well, what do you do? And you go, oh, I do all this. And they go, oh, man, I got my hands in the air every 3 minutes. That was amazing. I want that guy in my club.
Hey-ho.
Where's my lighter?
Yeah.
Oh, no, it's a phone.
No, it's a phone, yeah. That one's the... Yeah. What is that one? Yeah.
All right. Do you get that in China?
I do it. I'm like,
oh yeah. I saw you in Taiwan recently.
Yeah, actually, funny the thing. I was pretty much one of the only DJs to tour in the world last year.
Nice.
I got an opportunity to go to Taiwan for 9 shows.
Mm.
Very strange. I managed to somehow make it out of Bali without having COVID.
Right.
Go to Taiwan, tour for a month. Even go to Ultra Music Festival there.
Oh, right.
And then make
there it... There was an Ultra Music Festival.
Yeah, there was an Ultra Music Festival in Taiwan. And then make it back to Bali before they shut the border for Indonesia.
Wow.
Insane. It was a really strange time.
And how was it over there?
Completely free, like COVID did not exist.
Oh, right.
It was amazing. Amazing month. And the crowds there are just so good.
Mm.
My favorite country to play, probably.
So do you get paid a lot of money to do these shows?
It depends, mate. Like, yeah, in Asia for sure. Yeah. Like, festivals is where you make most of your money.
Mm.
And we'll just shaping up. Like, we kept growing each year with our festivals. And then for 2020, we had heaps of festivals for the year. We were booked out till August. And then COVID hit and then bye-bye DJ career.
what about the tracks? Do you like, people... play them out and record and blah blah.
So we had a lot of club music we were going to release, but we were more known for our social media. We had a lot of vocal tracks that did well online, but we didn't like they didn't not many DJs used to play some of these songs in their sets, if that makes sense. Kind of like just release songs and then tour, and then we had a lot of music. We have a heap of music we want to release, but we're just trying to find the right time.
And when you're playing out all around the world, you're playing your own music.
Oh, for sure, yeah. And every when I do our sets, it's always our own versions, our own edits. I make everything 100% customized in my sets.
Sure.
So I just want to play stuff no one else plays, you know.
That's a lot of work as well, right?
Yeah, for that Taiwan tour, I remember, like, I think I spent a whole month preparing just for the first show. And then because I was there, I did like the same venues each week, so each week I had to create a new show. It's a lot of work because I didn't want to just get up and play the same thing each week, so it's very time consuming, a lot of work.
And what programs and stuff do you
use? I just use Ableton for everything, but a lot of people use FL Studio, but I'm an Ableton guy.
Good old Ableton. An Apple guy, right?
Yeah. What is this you're running here? What kind of setup you got here, buddy?
Oh, we got a dodgy setup.
Running a Bill Gates system over here.
Yeah, Billy Gates. I don't mind Billy Gates.
Billy Gates is great.
You wouldn't want to buy a vaccine of him. But
what's he got, the AstraZeneca?
I think he's got the Microsoft one.
Yeah, micro COVID.
Microzine. Anyway, so you came... No, wait a minute. You got involved with Sean and Sky Garden.
Oh, yeah, I see.
In... Shishi.
Oh, you see, we want to talk about Shishi. Okay.
Well, you're now, that's your reason.
For being here.
Raison d'etre, you could say.
My raison toast. You said
raison toast?
Well, you said raison toast.
Raison d'etre.
So Sean and I met. Sean is the Sky Garden man. I didn't know Sean the first time, a few times I played at Sky Garden. Then I met him at a business conference in Macau, actually.
All right.
We just became good friends from there and. Went on a few more business trips together overseas. Business trips meaning Amsterdam.
Lots
of business in Amsterdam.
The dudes from DJ Mag, was it?
Yeah, all that stuff. And then we just became good friends for like a few years, and then he just kept hitting me up to come to Bali and do something with him, and I just kept saying no. I live in Australia. And then I keep thinking it's last year. We've lost a whole year of our lives. Exactly. And then he, in about October 2019, he approached me and wanted to see if I wanted to get involved in Shishi.
Mm.
And then at the time, I was like, you know, I was looking to diversify and do some more things and expand into business. And I was like, yeah, okay. Mm. You know, it took my
time. That was September or something. Yeah. When did it?
We opened it like pretty much like the last Saturday of November. But I just say start of December.
Yeah.
At the time, I thought it was the best idea in the world.
Yeah, sure.
I was like, touring
going gangbusters.
I was like, have the club in Bali, tour the world, you know? Yeah. And then 3 months later, all of it over.
And what have you brought into Shishi from you? What's your part down there?
Yeah, I look after all the entertainment. Before COVID, I book all the headliners, international, so I do all the deals for that. I manage all the DJs, you know, do all this, I handle all the entertainment side of
and
the business.
And that time when you were growing up in clubs and stuff, is that still, did you learn much about the game?
100%. That's why I wanted to stay in it and then kind of follow in my father's footsteps and get into the nightclub business.
Mm.
And that's literally why I did it, because I knew, like, I'll DJ as long as I can, but, you know, when I'm 45, I need to be in business as well, right?
Sure. Doing something.
Doing something.
Have a backstop.
Yeah, it's in my that's really my in my like roots, the club business. Mm. You know, I grew up with it my whole life. You know,
you love it.
I love it. I love a cold bintang on a Tuesday morning
after a very long night.
Yes, and a long interview with Stuart.
Very long dragging interview.
No, it's not dragging at all.
No, we're doing well.
Have you got a question sheet?
I've got a question sheet. I've got a whole page of them. Let's go.
Okay, question one.
What's your favorite fruit?
Watermelon.
Oh, shit.
Banana or apple? Apple.
I think some of these have already been... But best moments. Best moments as being a DJ.
Okay, this is a pretty amazing moment. So... I got booked to play this festival in Austria, 2019, Salzburg. It was called Electric Love. It's pretty much as big as Tomorrowland in Austria.
Mm.
I got to play after the Chainsmokers on main stage. Yeah, I got lucky. They had to go to Ultra Europe, and so I just managed to get a set time after them.
Right.
So I was plugging in my USB as they were finishing their set, and the Chainsmokers were at their absolute peak at this stage. They were doing their big song Closer, and like I think there was 30,000 or 40,000 people were singing it.
Wow.
And I was like, bloody hell, no one knows who I am. I was plugging in my USB and, you know, introducing Rave Radio. Hello. And then like turns around and walks away. But I thought it was a pretty amazing experience in Europe at a huge festival to play after the Chainsmokers.
So did you get get them on board?
Well, it's funny that when I met them backstage, they're absolute legends, by the way. I booked them for their very first gig on the Gold Coast when Selfie just came out years ago.
Okay.
And I paid them like such little money, and I brought it up with them. I said, remember I booked you? And I paid them like $4,000, like Australian.
Way back when.
Delivered, like when when that Selfie song came out, I booked them because I knew that was going to be big.
Mm.
And then 6 months later, the tour hadn't started. And that song had exploded, and I was like, wow, what a booking.
No, but what I mean is, did the crowd get on your... on your side?
Yeah, yeah. But it's hard getting on after an artist where the entire crowd knows who they are. So you had to like really get their trust back and build them up. But
that was a good experience for you.
It was an amazing experience, you know.
Mm. So what about the Bali music scene? What do you think, where it's at now? Well, it's hard to say right now, but an interesting thing, right? Actually, last weekend it was a lot different than what it's been for the last couple of months.
Yeah, I've definitely learned a lot being in Bali. Bali has its own ecosystem of clubbing. Like, it's music that's popular here is not popular anywhere else. It's got its own scene, its own thing going on, which I really enjoy. It's cool. Some of these house parties you go to are really, really cool and edgy and unique.
Yeah, a lot of people talk about Ibiza, don't they?
They do.
And here.
I think it's just going to get better and better. It feels... Yeah, I was really surprised when I came to Bali that they had a house scene the way they do, because to me it used to just be Kuta, right? Like, just
you'd never get outside of Sky Garden, I guess.
Yeah,
no, but the house scene's been strong here since
the problem we
the
have,
80s, really.
The problem we have here now in Bali is we have the same audience week in, week out, so they only are spread so far across everything, you know?
Well, it's still, you know, I've been down to Warehouse, and that, you know, when, you know, the escape show they had down there a couple of weeks ago.
Shout out to Kaiser Walden, by the way.
And Johnny.
Big Wilford.
I walked in, it was like totally rammed, you know. It's like 300, I don't know how many hundred people to get in there.
How good's Johnny's sets though, mate? Have you seen him and Wizdy back to back?
I have.
That a is few times. Old Wiz Dizzle, shout out to you. They're the best, mate. Love them.
And they the kids, you know, the people, the kids, they seem to appreciate it. And so, you know, that's right. On the back end of our last restrictions, I'd say, because it seems to have loosened off in the last couple of weeks.
Don't know what you're talking about, mate.
Yeah. I won't go any further than that. But anyway, that's cool. And that's very house.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Scene.
Yeah, yeah. It's definitely, it's crazy now when you go out, and you would know this, is you see the same people out every time now, hey?
Sort of.
It's crazy. But before you never
saw these Russians that you never see.
But you never see that before. There was a new batch of people in every, like, 4 days in Bali, new batch in and out.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
They come for 4 days.
Within the Seminyak kind of house scene and the Red Ruby,
yeah.
You know, the
shout
the
out to James Taylor.
Shishi and the Warehouse nowadays and whatever. It was that nucleus of people that are into that music too. Because the majority of people that come here on holidays, they're just interested in going to the place that's, you know, busiest and, you know, where there's the most chicks or something.
Yeah, that's true. You know, you're true.
They don't really give a shit.
I think when those days come back, it'll be much stronger. I just don't know how much. I don't know when.
EDM stronger.
No, or just like Bali, stronger? Bali. Like just in general, I think we're gonna have a few good years of like good times in Bali after COVID. Because I have no doubt.
It's gonna get very busy. What about EDM versus house when you're going out?
For sure. For me, house. Like towards the end, EDM, like I enjoy doing a good festival set and doing like heaps of energy and doing that, but I wouldn't go out and listen to EDM. You know, it is fun though. Like you still have fun when you go out with friends. It really depends the group of people you're with, but I personally would go to a house thing. I like house and techno and underground sounds.
I like to get high. High on life.
Wilford.
Okay.
Is that still going?
That's never really gone. Over here's gone. I hope. Let's check that out. Where are we?
Hey.
We're gone. There I am.
Oh, so that's still live?
Oh, yeah. Totally live.
On which platform?
On Twitch.
Oh, but that's Twitch.
Yeah, but that's Twitch. That streams to Twitch.
That is really Twitch.
No, it's actually called Streamlabs OBS, but
there we got comments.
Yeah. Oh, fuck you too. All right.
That's Hannah.
Was it? Hey, Hannah.
Hey, Hannah.
And it's Marcia. Hi. Well, anyway. Not too sure what's happening.
Wilford.
He's playing tonight, actually.
Shady Pig.
Yeah. Okay. What about sports and stuff? Do you do anything like that?
I played all sports. Funny, like I did all of them growing up. I actually broke my shoulder playing rugby at school.
All right.
I used to be a big lad, like
you were saying before.
So I was 14, I remember it clearly. I was the fat guy that had to do the hit-ups every time we had the 10-meter run.
All right.
And you I remember...
storm.
Yeah, I had to storm the beaches of Normandy, you know? Like, so I had to do this tap one time to this school, and I remember running as hard as I could. I remember my dad was on the side, like, can't look soft in front of my dad. And then I run in, there's eight dudes just come at me, and I'm like, well, this ain't going to end well. Sure. And then I've come in, too short, and I've hit the guy full pace, and my shoulder's just going like that. And then the whole ruck... Jame on top of me. Ooh. I'm like,
hello.
And then I was knocked out, basically.
Shit.
Should have seen the other guy.
Yeah. All eight of them.
Yeah.
So now, you're playing anything?
I was doing, before I came back to Bali, I was doing basketball every week. I like basketball. I did a couple of training sessions with the Bali Geckos, the AFL team, but wasn't really my thing. I just usually
go. There's rugby too here.
There's rugby?
Yeah.
What? Really?
Yeah, there's a rugby club. Similar to the Geckos.
Yeah, but I wouldn't play rugby in Bali. What kind of oval are you playing on?
They play down at Finns.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I played tennis. Well, the score, I played tennis again.
Tennis is great.
This week.
At the Umalas courts?
At Finn's.
Oh.
So Umalas courts. There's
Umalas tennis courts.
Oh, the
indoor ones.
Liga one.
Yeah.
Oh, no. I'm trying to find like some back of the house kind of casual.
I would play tennis with you if you play tennis.
Oh, you're way too young.
Oh, way too young?
Yeah. You'd run me around the place. I couldn't handle that. What about Love Life?
Huh?
Love Life?
Love Life?
Yes. Love Life is a DJ generally, and then you're Love Life now.
Well, I am seeing someone right now.
Oh.
DJ Hannah.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, you little sweeties.
Yeah. That's
quiet. We'll keep that quiet.
I just said it online, so
we better not talk about anything else. All right.
No, like you know.
How did you meet?
I think she used to. I met her at Shishi. She used to play at Shishi a bit. Oh, yeah,
sure.
And then, and then we didn't talk for a while, and then we talked, and then we didn't, and then talked again.
And there you are.
Here we are. 2021.
Rest is history. Well, I hope all the best for that. And so what's happening in the future with Rave Radio?
We're just trying to keep it, keep the wheels turning. It's really hard to say. Mm. Like, of course.
Nobody knows.
Want to get it back out there, but until the whole world's globalized.
Wait a minute. Was Rave Radio, it's two of you.
Yeah. James is in Australia right now. So he's been.
He was DJing as well?
Yeah, like James, we're still trying to do Rave Radio shows in Australia right now, just with him. But it's challenging. Like, the market's really bad. Like, the venues have almost gone bankrupt because of COVID. Yeah. They don't have any budgets to pay, and especially, like, artists in our fee bracket, they just can't afford. They pay their DJs $50 an hour now just to... And they can't afford thousands of dollars for a DJ to play for an hour at the moment, you know?
And especially what happened at... the Byron Bay Blues Fest last weekend.
Mate, how was that? Crazy, huh? So, like, this whole thing has just resetted the market again. Mm-hmm. Just as it was about to start recovering, it's gone back down now.
And, like, over one person that was, you know...
So, it's kind of... I really feel for so many artists in the entertainment business. Like, especially the DJs feels like it's just been wiped out overnight. Mm, like,
sure. Well, the entertainment business,
generally. The whole thing, but, like...
Except in... Petty Tingit. It all seems to happen down there.
Between Forge and Shishi, you know. That's always happening.
Yeah, exactly. Anyway, we won't talk about that, but if you're in the know, you know.
Now you know. Shout out to Wilford.
Out, back, in front, doesn't matter.
You're in. Free flow for ladies.
Is that still going on? Wednesday night?
Every night, mate.
Every night?
For girls.
Really? So if I wear a dress down the road... I got a drink.
Old Suzanne, you can come in anytime.
Suzanne.
Suzanne. Well, my female name's Brittany.
I'm not surprised. Anyways, great to have you. And so you're going to be around Bali, I guess. You're not going to be touring anywhere tonight?
No, I think I'm in Bali for the long haul. So people, you got to get used to me now.
Right.
I'm part of the furniture.
This is Brett.
Hi.
This is... DJST.
Yeah, Stu.
And I hope you've enjoyed our chat. We're going to go out with some music from Rave Radio, is it?
Ooh,
or
nice.
Or is it you?
Rave Radio.
Everything's Rave Radio. That's...
What have we got here?
We've got Rave Radio...
Spinning. Oh, you're going to do the mix.
Well, why not?
Just lay it down, Stu.
You got to tell me about it, though.
This is the mix we just done for Spinning Records for their radio show.
Let's make sure we're not on over here somewhere. Here we go.
There you go. This is our brand new track. What you're waiting for? Out on the Bingo Players label.
Bingo Players. They're quite regular here as well, weren't they?
I'm sure they play at Sky Garden, Bingo Players.
It's a bit loud for me.
Yeah. Is that a bit too bangy for the people?
Anyway, it's great. Good to talk to you, Brett.
Thanks for having me, Stu. It's been an honour. Feel like I've become Bali royalty sitting next to.
We'll see you down at Shishi over the weekend, the warehouse, and wherever else it is.
See you on the dance floor, buddy.
Okay. Cheers. Move that on. We'll be right back.
I'm not afraid to die. too close, turn to liquid like that. Sick and bold, can we keep it like that? And we never look back. Fill it up, motor oil like that. Bottle bomb and you light it like that. Throw it over your shoulder like that. And we never look back. baby, do that phone guy. No, you can't control yourself any longer. Come.
Baby, you've done, I think you've done enough.
Down.
down. I'm so reckless when you're around. Turn it upside down, turn it upside down. We are taking it way too far. Born like rebels without a cause. Keep them.
Somewhere in heaven.